Light 'em up, up, up. Let's roll.
The dungeon crawler hack and slash is a genre that's actually as old as modern gaming itself, teeming with classics that still hold up today, along with some stinkers that are best left forgotten. And although it's incredibly popular on the PC, console players rarely get the same love, though some of that really has to do with the often large array of keys used in these types of games for quick access to essential items and techniques. I'm not saying dungeon crawlers have to be simplified for an audience used to controllers, but I get the feeling that React Games sure felt that way when they made Super Dungeon Bros. Yeah, I'm talking about it. It's pretty well known that the initial release was garbage, but not a lot of reviewers really tackled why beyond bad netcode. Well, the game's been patched in an attempt to improve stability, remove bugs, and make playing the game an overall more enjoyable experience, and the question is, does this patch make the game worth playing? I mean, for $20. I don't know, $20 is a lot. The story of Super Dungeon Bros. Revolves around a crazy person by the name of Freddy picking a vinyl from the record store bargain bin and playing it backwards within earshot of his bros, annoying the crap out of them. When played backwards, a secret message is played that tells the four it's up to them to save Ball of Rock and the world from whatever, monsters or something. Who cares? There is no story. There is less effort put into giving these guys a reason to jump into the portal than some NES games. Even Gauntlet had a better story. And with that said, I will now take the time to spoil the ending for you. The characters available are nothing more than palette-swapped avatars with slightly different mugs and voices, carrying the names of famous rockers. Their personalities don't match the men whose names they've aped, and they tend to repeat chatter rather quickly. Also, there's no Dio.
Kono Dio da!
Truly, an error has been made here. But more on that in a bit, because with a threadbare narrative like the one present, the focus was definitely placed on making the gameplay 100% rockin', right? No, okay? The answer is no. This game is a twin-stick multiplayer crawler where players choose their character, customize their helmet, select the weapon, and attempt to clear dungeons before succumbing to the hordes of monsters ready and willing to send them to the afterlife. A team of up to four armor-clad adventurers proceeds through procedurally generated levels, blasting, cleaving, smashing, and filling specifically placed and somewhat randomly generated enemies full of holes. A mini-boss is faced every other death, that's what the levels are called here, and the bros square up against the dungeon keeper in the sixth and final level. Along the way, gold can be looted to either keep your characters breathing or strengthen them between levels, but you won't be doing both as the latter gets really expensive considering what little gold is acquired. The point was to possibly make choices of when to spend gold count, but in reality, this simply forces you to spend all the Skrilla you collect on stat upgrades to forego the need to refill your health. Oh, and only specific upgrades, since the usage of a certain technique is completely mishandled. Regardless of the weapon chosen, characters can use light, heavy, and ultimate attacks. However, depending on the weapon carried, some heavy and ultimate attacks can either be greats or awful, trending toward useless if it has a low utility. In addition, ultimate attacks are a precious commodity that don't refill with successful kills like any other game, and are only replenished by spending coin. Did I mention everything is expensive? You will not be using ultimates. Instead, the best builds revolve around using money earned killing things to boost the stats of your light attacks or anything that'll protect you. That's multiplayer or solo. Likewise, your choice of weapon, in general, is dependent on whether or not you're alone or in a group. Teams can benefit from a mixture of weapon types to round out the techniques used in combat, but solo players will have to stick to certain tools to clear all six levels. Like, preferably the ranged ones. Swords and hammers, while doing decent damage, leave you open to attack from ranged enemies, foes with large pools of HP, and area of effect damage. Crossbows and wands, especially after the December update, are strong and fast with short or no downtime due to reloading. You heard right, the crossbows reload. They also happen to be the best weapons in the game, so you take what you can get. Initially, you start off with only 2 weapons from a total of 16, but defeating bosses yields gems that allow you to forge new death dealers for different kinds of punishment. Fair warning though, the last weapons in the list are not the best, as they all have huge weaknesses that make using them impractical despite the payoff. The same applies to weapons that deal damage over time. They fail balance for group play, when diversifying is a fine choice and you want to get the highest score and prove you're the alpha bro. Or broette. Equal opportunity dickery available here.
Oh fuck,
I will pick you up and throw you.
That number means diddly squat when decking the halls with blood alone though. Unless you're shooting for one of the challenges, using a cauldron at the beginning of the dungeon to tweak the difficulty in various ways is a smart choice if you want to see things through to the end. You may not need them once you get good though, and there are two more available that allow you to prove just how alpha you are, bruh. As is customary of the genre, dungeons are rife with puzzles that sometimes require squad collaboration, but they mostly boil down to pulling levers and tossing bros at switches. There's really nothing to them, and I'm not even sure why I mentioned them, other than to lead into the fact that certain items and enemies can also be thrown. Also, a technique hardly used. I get the feeling there's going to be some obscure, high-level Super Dungeon Bro out there that'll dive into the comments years from now when people actually watch me for my reviews, and not my 3-year-old Ninja Turtles gameplay footage, telling me that tossing items is the path to victory, but who freaking cares? The overall gameplay design and presentation on display toss a salad.
Toss my salad!
And it's not winning anything with gamers. No matter how much you try to sweeten up something nasty, ass is ass. So let's get this out of the way. The graphics are decent, if unimaginative, and the sound and music are actually pretty good. Those are the positives. On a PC, this game has a tendency to run like garbage, sometimes chugging and freezing when playing on beautiful graphic settings. It makes no sense that there are even graphical settings to begin with, as idiosyncratic as they are, since barely anything changes to the untrained eye, and changing the resolution is what's more helpful when playing on weaker computers. The console version, prior to patching, had horrendous load times that have somewhat been fixed recently, but why that's the case makes no sense when this title looks like something that could be run last generation or even two gens back with maybe a dip in resolution. Sure, we could say that Unity was the culprit, but when you've got games that were released in 2016 that do more with the suite and also run better, you have to chalk the issues up to simple poor optimization. Two out of the three available dungeons are boring as crap, with only Cryptheim maintaining my interest with its combination of great enemy design, easy to understand pathways, and banging music. All three areas, being procedurally generated as I said earlier, suffer from serious cut and paste issues, with certain sections of levels repeating as soon as you leave them. Also, this may sound like a stretch for a $20 game, but three dungeons seems like a small number. When Torchlight 2 can have 1,200 room layouts and 44 unique areas and sell for the same price when it launched 4 years ago, we've got problems. I would be remiss if I also failed to mention that the four broettes are hidden behind a paywall I'm not even willing to climb, since the game really isn't worth it. Most egregiously for a game whose defining feature is supposed to be its multiplayer, the netcode is shit. We're talking drop a whole team from play for bad ping, freezing the game shit. I'm not pretending to be an expert here, I just know that however small your dev team is, when making a game that utilizes online servers or peer-to-peer networking, you need to have at least one person capable of writing strong code to keep players together. Otherwise, you won't have any. But okay, I was supposed to be telling you whether or not the game has improved post-patching, right? Well, I'd say yeah, definitely. Remember how I said ranged weapons were the best in the game, specifically singling out the crossbow as the top dog? In the pre-fun days, that's what I call them. Before the patch, you'd be stupid to even choose them, as they had terrible ammo stock, pitiful damage, and a reload delay that was 4 times as long as it is now. Actually, all weapons seem to have received the buff, as killing enemies is swift and satisfying compared to the day one release. In fact, so is movement. Dodge rolling more than twice in quick succession used to make a bro dizzy, but that penalty has been removed, leading to better combat flow and faster progression through the levels. Maxing out the threat meter now produces a warning that clearly tells you to haul ass, the effects of the dungeon cauldrons are more easily read, and the overall score for the entire run is now visible so you can see how you're faring when going for the daily and weekly challenges. But most of all, the balancing tweaks actually make soloing the game a believable prospect, meaning I won't have to go out and buy another Xbox controller because I smacked the previous one against a wall. With a bit of time invested learning the tricks and forging weapons solo, Super Dungeon Bros. Is a fun game with halfway decent balancing now, but it ain't worth $20, there isn't enough variety in the characters or maps, it isn't long enough, and the multiplayer is a non-starter unless you have 4 friends in the vicinity willing to endure the title with you. A bare minimum effort deserves a bare minimum price, and if you're still willing to bro it up, hit me up in the comments below. I'll play with you. Be sure to bring the jelly though.